school had an excellent drama program. Not only did we put on musicals like Godspell and West Side Story and Hello Dolly, we also wrote our own plays and took on the challenges of playwrights like Ibsen, Brecht, and Shakespeare. One year, I even had the privilege of playing Antigone in Jean Henri's version of the ancient Greek tragedy. Now, in addition to learning how to act in different types of plays, our teacher insisted that we learn the history and context of them. We studied Elizabethan drama and medieval pageant plays. We learned about Reformation drama, French farce, realism, and theater of the absurd. And of course, we received a strong education about ancient Greece, the birthplace of theater. Anyone familiar with the term Deus ex machina? It literally means God from a machine and describes how at the end of some Greek plays, a crane would bring in an actor who was playing one of the gods, hence God from a machine. And this god would then solve the problems that the characters had been wrestling with through the play. Over time, this phrase, Deus ex machina, has come to refer to any situation, especially in books, plays, or movies, where something unexpected or improbable happens to provide an impossible solution. Now, if I gave you a contemporary example, it would serve as a spoiler for others. So imagine a time when you were reading a book or watching a movie, and out of the blue, some character appeared and made everything go well. Or the superhero discovered a power that he had never had before. Or some force blew up all the bad guys while all the good guys lived. And poof, everyone had a happy ending. This kind of ending isn't very well thought of in literary circles. But to tell you the truth, sometimes I long for a Deus ex machina in real life. It would be so much easier than the long, hard work of justice and mercy. I wish for some miracle from God that would save the creation from all the harm that we're doing to it, and also wouldn't require us to give up the lifestyle that we are used to. Some blast of holy light that would end poverty and ensure that all God's children had plenty to eat and a warm and safe place to stay. Some magic wand that would take the water from all those places that are flooded and transport it and dump it on all the places with fires. Wouldn't that be cool? And also, the wand that would end war and put all the armies of the world to work building up rather than requiring them to destroy and kill. Some potion that would turn terrorists' hearts to love and make all the leaders wise and cure every disease. I'd love for us to receive a magical multi-million-dollar donation that would allow us to solve all the maintenance problems of the church, give double the grants to outreach, give the staff a raise, and build a recovery residence for women who are healing from the disease of addiction. Or heck, I'd even settle for some way to be able to eat all the holiday food I want and not gain any weight. But we don't have a God comes from a machine to solve all our problems. Instead of Deus ex machina, we have Deus nobiscum, Emmanuel, God with us. We have the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Sarah, Rebecca, Leah, and Rachel, the God who came not from a contrived mechanical device to save the day, but God who came to live on earth in relationship with us. We have God who became human in the person of Jesus, who started life on earth as a tiny infant, vulnerable to all the same things that we are. We have the God of love, not the God of magical power. Love that demands our all and costs our lives. Love that shares our suffering. Love that is abundant and never ending. Now, Jesus did perform some miracles that might have seemed like magic, but they were always for a particular purpose and usually to point people toward God. He did feed 5,000 people, but when Satan offered him the chance to turn stones into bread, to solve world hunger, he resisted the temptation. He didn't save his followers by riding at the head of an army and overthrowing the Romans. He didn't save his followers by eradicating poverty and disease. He didn't save his followers by hovering above them in power and glory, unraveling all their problems. He saved his followers by being among them and showing them how to live, by teaching them to pray, by telling them stories about planting seeds and pruning vines, by demonstrating the importance of caring for the least, the last, and the lost, by forgiving them for the things that they did wrong, and by showing them how to die to this life, trusting in the life that is to come. Now, you may be wondering what all this has to do with the first Sunday of Advent or today's scary-sounding gospel reading about the unexpected coming of the Son of Man. In a way, our reading sounds more like the Deus Ex Machina version of God, the Son of Man coming in power and great glory to sweep away evil, to pluck one person out of the field and another person out of the kitchen, leaving behind all the rest. But what if we hear this passage in a different way? Yes, Jesus is talking about signs of the end of the age and final judgment. Yes, the end of time could happen at any moment, and we will face that judgment. Yes, Jesus is urging us to stay awake and be ready. But maybe this story isn't about getting it right so that when we die, we don't have to face God's anger. Maybe this story isn't about the prepared person being raptured into heaven while the unprepared person gets left behind for some unknown but terrible fate. Maybe instead, this story is cautioning us to stay alert and ready, waiting for the appearances that Jesus makes right here and now. Maybe it's warning us to wake up from our distractions, whatever they may be, so that we are available and open for God to work in, with, and through us. Maybe it's encouraging us not to get so busy preparing for Christmas that we neglect to prepare for Christ. In this Advent season, we're not waiting for a magical God from a machine to come and save the day. We don't need to be afraid of the angry hall monitor in the sky who's checking off who's naughty or nice. What we need is to keep leaning in to the hard work of bringing about justice and mercy here in our little corner of the earth. Emmanuel, God is right here with us to strengthen and equip us and to inspire us for the work. We just need to open our eyes and hearts to see him. Our God didn't come from a machine. Our God came to be with us, to show us another way, to lead us into the difficult, costly, and oh so fulfilling way of love. Our God came to help us cast off the works of darkness and to put on the light of Christ. Deus nobiscum. God is with us.